with us are thousands of union members of the National Association of Labor Carriers.
A shout out once again for NALC President Fred Rolando. We've got to keep letter carriers on their roots, and as long as any of us are standing, we will fight to preserve six-day delivery. All of us standing together.
The last time we met, we were fighting for jobs at a rally with the AFL-CIO in downtown Los Angeles. A lot has happened since then.
I've taken on union bosses before. I'm happy to take them on again.
You just have to balance the needs of public employees against the needs of the taxpayers.
I support question two and Governor Kasich's effort to restrict collective bargaining.
Collective bargaining is not a right. It's an expensive entitlement.
Unions thrive in the dark. Secrecy is their greatest ally.
I will curb the practice we have in this country of giving union bosses an unfair advantage in contracting.
We'll make the unions understand full well that they are not needed, not wanted, and not welcome.
I will end the government's favoritism towards unions in contracting on federal projects.
Putting in place those labor stooges at the NLRB,
now stacked with union stooges.
Labor stooges.
Union stooges.
The bill I put forward isn't aimed at state workers, and it certainly isn't a battle with unions.
The first step is, we're going to deal with collective bargaining for all public employee unions. Because you divide and conquer.
And I will fight to repeal Davis-Bacon.
Divide and conquer.
And I will fight for right to work laws.
Divide and conquer.
When they were campaigning, they said, "We are focused like a laser on jobs, the economy," and the first thing they did is introduce right to work.
Union power.
What kind of power?
Union power.
What kind of power?
Every social issue on the book, voter ID, you name it, everything but.
Public employees are targets because we are unionized, and they're coming after unions, plain and simple.
It started in the last 2 years when the Republicans took over and the Tea Party took a stand, and they came after us to attack us, to take union rights so that we won't have a voice.
If we don't have our collective bargaining rights, what do we have? It'd be like in the 80s when Reagan fired all the air traffic controllers.
The memories have faded as to how we got to where we are today with the 40-hour work week, vacation time, or sick leave, or that sort of thing.
This was maybe the wake-up call for all of us, that if we don't get involved now, then we revert back to where we were some 40 years ago.
It's time for us to stop talking about it, walking about it. We got to be about it. We got to get people out to know the difference, to make a difference, to make a change. It don't stop here, it starts here. And today and from now on, we will be fighting, we will be pushing, we will be standing up together for each other's right until we get a change.
Our lives are at stake now, and it's not easy when you're fighting alone. We have strength and unity, and we just want to make sure that all our carriers are unified to continue to fight and the struggle that we have ahead of us.
Big business has decimated unions in the private sector. Now it's our turn. Now they're coming after us. And I think it's important that we have the solidarity of the complete labor movement to fight this.
So we all need to stand together if we're gonna succeed in this battle to snuff out right-to-work legislation, which is going to come back. As long as they have the money to support those issues, we'll have to fight them.
We are really the last stand for labor unions as we know it. And labor unions go down, so does the middle class.
Jason became sort of the center of the labor universe for quite a while, a year or so ago, and it really energized labor folks across the nation when Governor Walker did what he did and took those collective bargaining rights away. People were incensed, and the spraying into action was amazing. Letter carriers were part of it. They were there from day one. Even though the legislation that happened in Madison didn't affect letter carriers directly, it was an injury to one is an injury to all, and that's really where we were at.
We see the people coming together again. We've seen it up in Wisconsin. We've seen it in Ohio and Indiana. People are coming together across all spectrums.
You talk about firefighters, teachers. Those are professional people who we think put them at the highest esteem of our day-to-day operations. And for them to come after them and attack them, you know, we're going to come after us next.
What he campaigned on of jobs, and then to go turn around and really cut the knees out of organized labor, it was pretty obvious that that was his intention all in all.
So Governor Walker, America's letter carriers have a message for you. Stop your assault on workers in Wisconsin. Withdraw your draconian proposals. Listen to the vast majority of people in your state who oppose your power grab. Kill the bill.
Win some battles, we're going to lose some battles. We weren't particularly happy with what happened in Wisconsin, but look at what happened in Ohio and Minnesota and New Hampshire, and we've just got to stay focused. I don't believe that anybody has addressed the issues that face us with any type of long-term plan. It's all short-term fix, kick the can. And that includes not only the leadership of the Postal Service, the Postmaster General, the Board of Governors, and so forth, but the Congress themselves.
The so-called Postmaster General is going to announce details that will lead to the end of the United States Postal Service and universal postal delivery in this country.
We have a bill by Representatives Issa and Ross that would pretty much dismantle the Postal Service.
We support the ability to move and consolidate the network. We support the ability to move to consolidate from 6 day to 5 day delivery. Practically everything in the bill, we are in support.
This guy, this so-called Postmaster General, who should be fired because of a lack of any imagination or initiative, is proposing the death knell for the great United States Postal Service.
I fear that the Postmaster General's approach would shrink the Postal Service to a level that will ultimately hasten its insolvency.
If the Post Office is trying to compete against the instantaneous communications of email, what does it mean that you are slowing down significantly mail service? Cut back on the workforce of the Postal Service by 40% over 200,000 American workers. Many of them, by the way, veterans.
100,000 people laid off. Oh, that's just what we need in America today. Let's lay off 100,000 people. Great idea.
So I find myself in a quandary, one created by the Postmaster General himself, as he shifts from plan to plan, from negotiation to negotiation.
Darrell Issa's shoving this down our throats. I don't know what his agenda is, but it's not based on our needs.
Congress is taking the wrong track. They're trying to correct a problem that does not exist, and they need to go back to the drawing board and do what's right.
Public employees have sort of been made the scapegoat for many of the financial issues happening with government now.
Public employees are just natural targets because they represent many things that these right-wing people despise.
We don't have the ability to get locked out of our jobs, but that's what they'd love to do to us. They'd love to take us down. They'd love to be able to kick us out of our jobs and privatize every facet of the government.
Why aren't people aspiring to the things that we have, the protections they have, the voice in their own workplace, and all those sorts of things? Why aren't those being looked at as being goals rather than something that they should be somehow jealous of?
We're talking about damage to so much more than the Postal Service. We're not just talking about the letter carriers. We're not just talking about postal employees. We're talking about the middle class here.
So we're talking a lot of people out of work, a lot of industries going under because of it, the mailing industry, the printing industry. There's a lot of things that are tied to the post office that people don't realize.
If you were the CEO of a large business and your competitor was functioning 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, would you cut service?
The Postal Service is really the cornerstone for a much larger industry of about, you know, $1.3 trillion, which affects 7 to 8 million workers, most of them being private sector. And I don't think a lot of these people that want to attack unions and want to attack government, want to attack the middle class, realize the effect that they're having on the businesses that they supposedly support.
The post office is being destroyed by Congress, and we're here to save it.
Nothing will bring carriers together more than a fight, something that they can all come together on, and we're in the fight for our lives right now.
We was kind of learning from Wisconsin and seeing, you know, this could happen anywhere. Let's get out in front of it.
The NALC is fighting this battle on so many different fronts. We've got the legislative front, we've got the political front, we're constantly dealing with the media. And at the same time, we've got to take the lead in developing a long-term plan for the future, because nobody else is going to do that for us. We have to fight those that want to just dismantle the Postal Service at the same time with legislation, whether it's going to 5-day to 3-day or closing post offices or consolidations that would affect the service standards that help make our networks as valuable as they are. Politically, we have to constantly look at what's going on there.
We don't need an artificial crisis.
It's going to put us in a position where we may not be able to adapt.
The UPS FedEx model doesn't work without the post office.
Yep.
We're going to have ups, we're going to have downs, but overall, we need to be optimistic about how this thing is going to end, because we're not going to stop fighting. With regard to a long-term strategy, we're really all alone there. The Congress is certainly not doing that. The Postal Service is certainly not doing that. The NALC has had to take the lead. You know, we're letter carriers. We've turned to the professionals that do this type thing for a living to ask them, is there a business here? Or is what the Postal Service is doing, is that the only way to go, is to dismantle the service?
If you want to have a world-class post office, you have to have a vibrant network. And what the Postal Service has come forward with is a series of initiatives to degrade the network.
As we suspected all along, the initial report that we've gotten from Lazard and Ron Bloom clearly indicates that the Postal Service is going down the wrong road. They do not have a business plan. There is certainly business there to be pursued. The activism of our members has been absolutely remarkable. This past September, we decided that we would go to every congressional district office around the country to educate the public and solicit support for 1351 in the House of Representatives. We had over 500 rallies around the country with great participation, wonderful press coverage. The members absolutely stepped up.
Day in and day out, all they hear is the big postal lies on TV and the radio and the newspapers that we're broke, that we're obsolete, that we're looking for a bailout. So this is our opportunity to talk to the public and thank the Congress and encourage them to do the right thing.
Also last fall, we asked our members to go out and solicit petitions from the public, from businesses and so forth, to see if we could obtain about 1 million signatures to support a 6-day delivery.
We showed up at farmers markets, Saturday markets, wherever there was an opening on a Sunday for a letter carrier to collect petition signatures about 6-day delivery, we were there.
And incredibly, in about a 2-month period of time, our members were able to get over 1 million signatures in support of the American people for 6-day delivery. And earlier this year, in April, We asked our members to get out and rally Senate offices all over the country in opposition of 1789. And once again, the members stepped up incredibly.
The letter carriers were buzzing about it for days afterwards. I never seen them so energized about an event and an issue in our corner than that rally.
On the media front, rarely does a day go by that I don't have to respond in some way, shape, or form to something, whether it's a newspaper article, something we hear on the radio, something on TV. But what's important is that the people are given the right information or told the truth, and that's our front with the media.
You should say hello to your letter carrier while you still can, because you may soon be saying goodbye. Back in 2006, Congress passed a bill that needlessly drains the Postal Service of billions of dollars each year. Now, some in Congress advocate shutting local post offices and eliminating Saturday and door-to-door delivery. They would rather cut your services than fix the problem Congress created. Dismantling the Postal Service is not the way to save it. Tell Congress, vote no on H.R. 2309.
It's amazing what our members have done in op-eds and newspaper articles and radio shows and interviews. It's absolutely amazing.
So they passed this law that said, with all this extra money, let's just fund all the retiree stuff in 10 years. For an obligation that'll go on from today until the earth stops spinning.
Businesses want to get mail delivered on Saturday, but H.R. 2309 would not only eliminate Saturday delivery, it would eliminate door-to-door delivery for millions of people.
The Postmaster General constantly talks about eliminating a day of delivery. Well, what do you think the mailers are going to do? You don't help a business or grow a business by taking service away.
Who does the best job, your mail or Congress?
This uniform made in America. So when you put us out of business, the people make these shirts just got unemployed too. None of this is even necessary. Just give us back the so-called surplus and let us be the Postal Service and we'll deliver.
We are paying health benefits, retiree health benefits for people that have not been born yet. I mean, that is just crazy.
Suspend the prepayment of $5.5 billion a year to pre-fund health benefits for retirees.
No other company, no government entity has to pay this but the Postal Service. And if anyone else had this, they would, you know, no company could survive.
Then they need to do something about that congressional mandate, because if they don't take care of that, you can keep closing offices and cutting, and you're just going to drive more mail out of the system and really not fix anything.
So slow the mail down. Let's face it, we're already called snail mail. Do we need to go slower? The faster the Postal Service wants to do.
The fastest growing part of postal business is packages. People are buying more things online. Somebody has to deliver those.
We're the thread in the social fabric of society. We weave in and out of every house every day. And because of that, we save people, we put out fires, we find elderly who are in distress. If you take that away and you take that door-to-door delivery away, take away that connection that people have.
Very important. It's important for the nation, for the country, for the economy.
It's encouraging to hear our message over and over and over and realize how focused our members are as they try to educate the media and the American people as the truth of what's going on.
Congress doesn't deliver. We do.
Keep the Postal Service and let Congress walk.
What this reckless move demonstrates is an attitude that is dead set on letting the service deteriorate and ignoring what customers want.
I live in a retirement community where I know that cutting back on delivery will make a difference to the residents that are my friends and my neighbors.
Customers are the most important people, okay? We have to be the delivery service of choice with them in order to stay in business.
Customers support, actually support the couriers. We're part of the community. We're in their lives every day of the week,
6 days a week, and the Postal Service is trying to cut it to five.
We've had six-day delivery for forever, and we need to keep that. I mean, the customers have come to expect it.
They want to see us out on the street. They want to have the six-day delivery. The American public is very supportive of our movement.
I want that mail delivery 6 days a week. I want to be able to mail presents to my grandsons in Massachusetts.
The senators can't just hear that letter carriers want to save six-day delivery. They have to hear about how important it is to serve the elderly and to serve rural areas and even the lower-income areas.
They have done everything from save lives to shovel driveways to be good neighbors. They're not just employees. They're pillars of the community.
Letter carriers take pride. These are their people, these are their neighborhoods, and you don't mess with them. Whether it's a fire or a criminal or whatever it is, letter carriers take pride in their communities, and people recognize that.
We love our customers, we're all about providing service, and I think if we would go away, more people would miss us than they think they would.
So I believe really strongly that we need to keep six-day delivery, and you guys need to keep going.
Solidarity means change, change for the good, correcting problems, correcting the ills, and in this case, the post office.
I mean, we are at a tipping point, and we need solidarity like we've never had before.
Solidarity means that no matter what happens to me, my brothers and sisters will be there to back me up, that the union stays strong.
Letter carriers are the natural messengers for solidarity. We're in every community. We talk to our customers. We're the highest valued government employees out there.
This environment requires us to get out shoulder to shoulder and show a real presence to the community that we exude solidarity.
Solidarity means coming out in 35 degree weather in a rainstorm and standing shoulder to shoulder with Americans who want to save a service.
I mean, this is how we're going to save the post office, is our solidarity with the general public as a whole. That's how we win this battle.
This is a war being waged on the middle class, and people need to understand that. It's not about unions or goons. It's about working people that work every day for a living, your friends, your family, your neighbors, your firefighters, your policemen, your teachers, your nurses, your postal employees, people that work every day and wanting a fair wage and health insurance and retirement versus corporate greed. That's what this war is about. And solidarity is very important in this country right now with regard to the whole middle class and the survival of the middle class.
It's not enough to just pay dues and be a member of the union anymore. Not in this environment.
Yeah, actually, it's time to get off their butts. Be aware of what's going on. Become active with your union.
Because the strength of this union, hasn't changed. It's the numbers. We're 280,000 strong, and that's what makes this this union successful. And we need every member, no matter what their role is, to stay focused and to stay educated.
They need to take every opportunity that they have to get this message out that we really need to keep six-day delivery.
Stay informed, stay educated, talk to their friends, talk to their family, talk to their neighbors.
Get involved. Know what's going on around you. Go to branch meetings, go to union meetings, go to listen to a newsletter, get on e-activists.
And when they talk to you about, hey, what's going on with six-day delivery, tell them the truth. Say, hey, we're not broke. You know, Congress created this problem and they can fix it.
The next 2 years, just like the last 2 years, are going to be very busy for all of us. And I think it's important that each and every member do everything they can to stay educated, to stay focused, and to stay unified. Because if we do that, nothing can stop us. We will continue to be successful because the NALC will not back down.
When I've seen letter carriers at their best is when they have a big fight on their hands.
And it's more important than ever, really now, that workers have a voice in the workplace.
We have the best delivery service standards. We have the best network out there. We go to every house, every day, every delivery.
I keep telling my letter carriers, you're our salesman.
You're the one who carry our message, and you carry it by giving great service every day.
I want people to understand what we do is more about a service than a product.
Be out there looking for avenues of revenue and new sources of income.
There are a lot of things we could do besides just deliver the mail.
We want to continue to serve the entire American public.
You know, it's not a red post office. It's not a blue post office. It's a red, white, and blue post office. It belongs to the American people.
So when you're out there every day and you're dealing with these issues and you're thinking about the legislation, you're thinking about the lack of a business plan and the attacks with some of the bills and the destruction of the networks by the Postmaster General and so forth, or maybe you're just putting up with the harassment on the workroom floor of a supervisor who's being pushed to make you do more. Keep in mind what you stand for and what you really are. You are the face of the Postal Service, and the American people say they trust you more than any other federal employee. And that's because of what we do day in and day out. Don't you forget it. This is our fight. This is our future.